This is Dead Serious, a show about short horror stories worthy of discussion. I'm Dead Pallet, and I'm reading an SCP entry, Holy Rollers. At this moment in non-time, we're going to be continuing our journey through the Remembrance Files at the SCP Foundation website. As always, links are in the description, but if you haven't seen the previous episodes, starting with SCP-332, then I would highly recommend you check those out before listening to this one. But let's get right into it. Remembrance Part 2. Lee was there, walking through the dead halls and broken doors, in his pressed uniform. They'd left him behind. Everyone else had been taken out to play. Lee continued his march. They would be back soon. Syncope would always have a place for his percussion. Above him, the announcers added their steps to the beat. Lee looked on, keeping in step, to see what the tune would be today. So this is a perfectly serviceable establishing shot, but I'm not sure what the context is for how we're getting this information. Previously we were given a diary, and then we were given what seemed to be school announcements of some kind. How we got those, I'm also unsure. But this just seems to be a detached third-person narration, and I'm not sure where it's coming from. I hope that is explained. Hello, students. This is Principal Wehrner. Mitchell decided that it was high time to take a step back in responsibility and that he's going to groove to another beat. That's okay. We'll grow onwards. Like the spire of the Eiffel Tower, we will inspire many people to create the parachute so that they may safely live with the stars. Nobody will be excluded from further activity. We've brought everyone here together to be together. Have a good year. Okay, so we're getting a part of what was in a previous file as what I'm assuming is some sort of morning announcement or afternoon announcement played over the loudspeakers at the school. Again, I really wish I would have that information. I'm invested in the story. I would just like some establishing. I would like to establish how we are being given this information, since documentation is such a huge part of these stories. The rest of the school didn't seem to mind. Some of them had kept acting like nothing had changed, walking like scarecrows in a dead field. Some just sat there, watching people go by. Lee didn't care to ask them what they were looking at. He remembered walking down the hall, seeing the old faces singing. When their voices gave out, they whistled. And when their lips went out, they beat the drum. Okay. This does establish for us that it is a scenario where people are, it was like my North Korean theory of the more that you play along, the higher your ranks are within this sort of prison camp where people are forced to march to the beat of the drum, where there's a kind of religion around music, an ideology built around music. However, I this is a sticking point, and I know I'm starting to sound like a broken record. Where are we getting this information from? Because the SCP is all about this materialistic establishing of its narrative. It's all about giving you these documents and explaining where they came from. However, we haven't been given information as to how we're getting this. These remembrance links are hyperlinked to the other stories, starting with SCP-332, but not sure what to make of this yet. Might be disappointed if we're not given information as to how this information is in our hands. Students, you may have noticed the new schedule system. We've divided everyone into 6 populations and given them each their own position in the school. I know this radical restructuring seems to have come out of nowhere, but trust us, it's been a long time coming. Now please stand with me for the symphonic allegiance and sing your hearts out with style. Okay, so this is again confirming my idea that there is a ranking system based on how high up you are in the Syncope Symphony cult, how dedicated you are to that, how much of your allegiance you're pledging to them. Syncope was here. Lee could feel it in his sinew, twanging them like a banjo. From the band equipment, From the band equipment came its force and its glory. Before he could go on to think of 11 new wonderful things to say about the matter, Lee clenched his fist. Leg turned to run, but only at an awkward stance. The vibrations in his sinew grappled him by the lapel and pushed him forward like a wind-up clock. Like a wind-up clock. Okay, so this is a new wrinkle here. We previously thought that Lee was in full allegiance. I'm not sure if this is happening before or after he started his transformation in his journals. So either he was initially rebellious or was somehow starting to overcome the force of the Syncope symphony instruments. Timeline really hasn't been established yet. Students, we're sad to report that we've had to let some staff and students go. Although they were bravely carrying on their duties, in the end, there's only room for so many, and in the orchestra of life, please listen in silence as we commemorate those who have gone to another place. They hear of anything we say. All of us now, hearing the panting, running crowds, the bells, and the blackboards, the song. So presumably, they died of exhaustion, and that's what they're referring to. Lee stopped playing. Cold pains were in him. Oh God, it hurts. The things crawled into his back from his arms, twisting up to their heads, to his head. This isn't harmony. He tried to take a step, but fell, sprawling his limbs akimbo as he slammed into the ground. Where was his place in the symphony? I don't think akimbo was in the lexicon of American youths in 1976. I am really getting confused as to where we're getting this information from, because we have one paragraph that seems to be an omnipotent third-person speaker. You know, it's God telling you down from heaven, here is what happened. But then the next paragraph is in italics, and then it says what is presumably being played over the loudspeaker. Again, where we're getting a notification of what was played at the loudspeaker at that time, I do not know. But this most recent paragraph is extremely perplexing because Lee stopped playing. Cold pains were in him. Oh God, it hurts. It seems to be going within the paragraph between the God narration and what Lee is thinking. It's really confusing me, and not in a positive way, I don't think. It was punishment. An arm stretched out, grabbing for purchase. He needed to get out. Playing all was all he needed to do. Cindy and the others would be waiting for him there to play with. Panting, he clutched his chest. An icy bubble welled in his chest and pressed against him. He couldn't breathe. Think, oh God, where is this going? Have to remember. Now. And then it says, as its own paragraph break, rest, in a smaller font. So it's unclear when he says, or whoever is speaking here, because again, we get the confusing perspective. It's supposed to mimic multiple voices in his head, but I don't know who the third person narrator would be in that case, and why they are able to be inside of his head, and why we are hearing from them. But it's unclear whether when he says Cindy is over there, if he wants to join her and she's brainwashed as well, or if she somehow managed to escape and he's trying to get to where whatever the haven is to meet up with them. This is starting to lose me a little bit, quite honestly, and that's saddening because I was really getting enthralled in the last part of Remembrance. The rising crescendo was there, faint at first, but growing. Weakly, he pursed his lips and croaked out a whistle. The crescendo grew. Oh, the beauty, the grace. Let it take him, bring him back to his note. Lee closed his eyes and slept. Then there's a paragraph break and ellipses. Okay. So maybe this is Syncope Symphony or someone from Syncope Symphony, their perspective, their ability to get into his mind. But here we have a series of single lines that are written in italics and quotes. Hey, find any more? One, a guy who looked like he had been in the band, found him in the upstairs hall, having some kind of fit. Put him in the third room, I think. Some agent should give him Class A and stop and drop him later. Can I get a hand? These kids are kind of heavy. Okay, so this is obviously from the perspective of the mobile task force that is being dispatched there. However, I don't know why we're being given dialogue in this manner. Seems to undermine the entire premise of SCP, which is that these are a series of legal documents, you know, that kind of liturgical way about going things. We're again given a different font style, this time more of a typewriter typeface. Students are reminded that only band members are permitted off-school premises. Any violators will be dealt with their own consequences. Their actions have only damned themselves. So it's just reiterating that point. But now we're going to get back into the normal writing that is maybe God, or maybe Lee, or maybe Syncope Symphony, or maybe all three. It's not clear. Lee woke up on his back, facing up to some place in the dark. With a throbbing heart, he swiveled his head back and forth, trying to hear it. There was only a low buzz, sounding like a lean, hungry mosquito. No melody, no tune. Taking a step, his leg nearly buckled beneath him. Clutching his leg to keep from falling over, he didn't feel the suit. Just thin, bare cloth. Uniform. Gone. Instrument. Gone. Music. Gone. Lee tried to step again, sluggishly stumbling. Why did they send him? These things happened before there was a reason for them not to. So it should be over. The buzzing grew louder. Lee had to get back. Home. School was home. Lee struggled, the pounding slithering up from his heart, through his throat, into his head. They were doing the music, and he had to be there now. So there's two things that we've gleaned from this. One is that his uniform and instrument, Lee's uniform and instrument, have been taken away from him, and he has been taken by the mobile task force and put in some sort of containment chamber. However, we really can't get much more information from that. It's because it's written in this weird, stagnated way that doesn't match the rest of the story. Someone said something. Please, they said to forget. Lee shook his head, tears streaming down his cheeks. Sin, how did the tune go? What did they sing? They never sang, Lee. You forgot. It's so easy to forget, isn't it? The ringing grew louder, and they stopped talking to him. Louder and whiter. We won't forget you. So I don't know what the process is here on whether all of these SCPs were written by the same person or who they were edited by, but this feels like a different authorship from everything else that I've read so far. The first one, 223, kind of feels different from the rest as well, but not in a way where it's potentially detrimental for the SCP's believability to me. And it's worthwhile noting that I'm judging this from the Ashcan perspective of I want everything to be radically grounded to real life, and having an omnipotent narrator that isn't justified in some way violates that for me, at least. So Remembrance Part 2 is a little bit of a disappointment. Looking down at the bottom, it has two tags attached to it. One is Class of 76, which is the series of stories we're reading and everything, but the other one is a tag that's just tale, as in, you know, a story. And I get the feeling that anything with that tag in the SCP Foundation is going to be a disappointment to me, and probably in my personal judgment doesn't fit with what is going on in the SCP as a whole. However, I'm not ready to damn the story on this part alone. I'm going to move on to the second interlude. In Session is what it is titled. This begins with a quote from an unknown admirer. Do you remember the bells when the bells had to ring? Can you tell me how the children used to sing, and now there's a series of what looks to be excerpts from something. We're finally leaving for the trip. It's been a hell of a ride getting there, but now we have it, the whole summer on the road. Nothing in our way but the freedom to ride the bins, turning whenever we feel like. Alright? Rusty has his dad's wrecked up old Chevy for us to ride in, and he's going to be driving. That's the first excerpt, so this seems to be relating to an SCP that we read previously. This might be in reference to SCP-1423, where it's the photograph that gives you nostalgic memories of the last summer vacation you had, and then slowly replaces them with the specific trip being mentioned here. I believe that's what's going on. First day of the drive, and I'm pumped. We got Rusty in front, Lee in the passenger seat, with me and Andy chilling in the back. Which seat should I take? No, it's pretty nice. First place we're hitting up is the Black Ridge Rock Extravaganza. I remember going there. It was amazing. Really what opened me up for my interest in rock. Everyone's going to have a blast. Cindy and Lee are real pumped for it. I hope they don't end up pass out drunk on the field again. So we don't know who our narrator is just yet, but they are friends with Cindy and Lee. Driving down the road to Ohio must get boring after a while, but Rusty manages to keep is going. I remember him telling all these wise-ass remarks about passing landmarks and people, but that was only when we were driving in the city. This is farmland. I can't write right now. My head is blah. Okay, so we're getting a few spelling mistakes here. A few typos, and I'm not sure if that's intentional or accidental. It certainly kind of feels accidental. Context clues are making me think that that's the case because we haven't really gotten those kinds of mistakes before. On the road again. I remember the road again. Roads again. Maybe this is purposeful because I is uncapitalized and remember is spelled wrong. This is a different narrator than we've ever had before, so that's certainly a possibility. We must be lost. I don't recall ever having been stuck this long without seeing an open road, or a turn, or even another house. All we get is one straight, flat road, stretching on for what seems like ages. God, this must be turning out to be a less than stellar opening to our last memorable summer. I very much so can relate to that when you feel that there is a pressure put upon you to have a good time at a specific period in time, which is why I generally am not a big person on vacations, because then there's like this pressure put upon you of like, well, you better have a good time, and that is what our narrator is feeling here. Rusty is an idiot. The first house we see for days, and he bolts by it. Apparently he had bad memories about this place, or some other hippie bullshit like that. You can't fucking have memories of shit you never saw. He says, then he has the nerve to not let anyone else drive because he's supposed to be the driver. Wait, I forgot. Did Lee ever drive? All right. So two things are interesting here. One, they have been driving for days and haven't seen another house or a building or anything, or even a proper road, apparently. They're driving through nothingness? It's starting to sound a lot like Arizona, and that could be a good thing or that could be a bad thing, depending on what happens next. Second thing of note is that our driver, Rusty, is apparently having memories of something he didn't do. This is tying in some fashion to SCP-1423, however, in one way, I cannot know just yet. We left Rusty here today. When we came back, he was gone. Where here is, I'm not sure, but so that's a little confusing, but that staccato excerpt right there, I think, is very effective. The car is no longer now. I don't know how, but I do. The lights in my teeth are getting brighter, and the eyes of my light are brighter. I'm sharp. Yeah, this is feeling like it's written by a different author, quite honestly, because before, in Remembrance Part 1, we had a slow, gradual build-up from very prose-like writing to very poetic writing, but here it's happening in a very sudden manner. Don't know what to make of that. However, this is not the end of this tale. This isn't even the end of the Remembrance Files. We have Remembrance Part 3 and Epilogue, Last Word, to go next on Dead Serious. Now, if you enjoyed that, consider helping out the community and supporting my channel. You can support the community by conversing in the comments below, going to toospooky.com, that's toospooky.com for more original horror stories, and trying your hand at writing short horror yourself. You can support me by liking this video, following me on Twitter, Tumblr, links down in the description, and checking out my art page as well. Thank you so much for your time, and now on to our sponsor at this non-moment in time. Tiger Knee. Tiger Knee? Come on, man, no secret moves.